Good afternoon and welcome to our program, Artists at Work. I'm so glad that many of you could join us for this conversation in what it takes to make art possible. The American Academy of Arts and Sciences was founded in 1780 to honor excellence and address the most important issues to the nation. And the arts are a foundational element of both our work and our membership. Each year, alongside scientists, philosophers, lawyers, business people, and academics, the Academy elects artists into our ranks. In the most recent election, just announced a few weeks ago, we were thrilled to honor such talents as jazz trumpeter Terrence Blanchard, cinematographer Arthur Jaffa, playwright Susan Laurie Parks, dance critic Jennifer Homans, and the band's Robbie Robertson, among others. The arts also feature prominently in our events and publications, and in recent issues of our quarterly journal, Daedalus, on the novel and why jazz still matters. Despite the centrality of the arts to our work and to our mission, until recently, the Academy had never had a formal programmatic effort focused on the arts and culture. That changed in 2019, when, under the leadership of poet Natasha Trethewey, actor John Lithgow, and Kennedy Center President Deborah Rutter, the American Academy began its three-year Commission on the Arts. The Commission is made up of artists, educators, scholars, and arts leaders who have dedicated their careers to the arts and who are united in their belief that the arts are essential to a healthy individual and civic life. The Commission has been exploring the transformative role the arts and artists can have on society, focusing its attention on the role of the arts in education, in community and economic development, in civic engagement, and in the lives of everyday Americans. Their efforts, which include two forthcoming reports and a series of public activities, are designed to help municipalities, institutions, patrons, and artists themselves ensure the centrality of the arts to 21st century American life. We're grateful to our commissioners for their hard work and to those whose generous support makes this work possible, especially the Barr Foundation, Ford Foundation, Getty Foundation, John S. and James K. Knight Foundation, Kresge Foundation, and Roger and Victoria Sant. The COVID-19 pandemic and recent civic crises have both reinforced the value of the arts and exposed the longstanding needs of arts practitioners. Today's conversation is an important step in our mission to ensure that America develops the structures necessary to allow the vast and multidimensional creative workforce to thrive in every kind of community from coast to coast. It's worth noting that we are not alone in this mission. We acknowledge the many efforts underway by like-minded organizations around the country. In fact, there's an ongoing program also named Artists at Work that was conceived by the production company The Office Performing Arts and Film in collaboration with the Fresh Grass Foundation and is a separate, wonderful example of an effort to develop creative workforce resilience. It's now my pleasure to turn things over to one of our commissioners, Laura Zabel. Laura is the executive director of Springboard for the Arts, an artistic-led economic development agency based in Minnesota. Springboard provides entrepreneurship training and other resources for artists, in addition to running innovative programs such as artists' access to healthcare and community-supported art, which connects artists directly with patrons. Laura will lead a discussion with Oskar Eustis and Thelma Golden on what it takes to make art possible and what support artists and creative workers need to thrive in this country. As field leaders, each of our presenters bring an essential perspective on the role that institutions and workforce policy have played for creative workers in the past, play now in the midst of immense crises, and most importantly, should play as we look to the future. Following this discussion, there will be a period of Q&A. I encourage all members of the audience to participate at that time. Please use the Q&A feature found in Zoom to submit your questions. We'll do our best to get to as many as possible in the time allowed. Laura.
Thank you so much, David. It's really a pleasure and an honor to be here with all of you today. Like David said, my name is Laura Zabel. I'm the executive director of an organization called Springboard for the Arts. And it's just been such a pleasure to be part of the Academy's Commission on the Arts and to get to be a part and chair the subcommittee on community and economic development. And as we're leading to the end of the commission and considering this forthcoming report, which sounds very important, that will come out of this committee, I've been reflecting back on just how much has changed and happened, of course, in our world, but specifically in the lives of artists over these 2.5 years now. When we first kind of convened the subcommittee on arts and community development in 2019, we sort of challenged ourselves with this question: what would a new WPA or Works Progress Administration for artists look like in this country? And I think for me, at least, that question was never really a policy recommendation or even a recommendation that we should replicate in structure the actual WPA, but more a kind of invocation to boldness and scale. And particularly important to me and the work that I care the most about in the world, a reminder to ourselves that we wanted to start specifically with individual artists in our conversation and center the lives of creative workers and artists in the work that we were doing. And to really dig into their value and the tangible value that artists provide their communities in all kinds of different ways. Then of course, 2020 happened, and we all kind of had a first row seat to how fragile the lives and livelihoods of artists are. It's of course not unique just to the arts. The pandemic and the economic crisis have really exposed how much our economy relies on gig work, on self-employment, on contract workers, relies on low wages and work that provides little to no safety net when a crisis happens. The majority of Americans, even pre-pandemic, couldn't weather a $400 emergency in their lives. And that includes a lot of artists and a lot of the people that we depend on to do this cultural work. But maybe more optimistically, we are also in a moment where I think there are just a lot of people in the world and in the country and in the field of arts and culture who are determined to not return to normal, but to really imagine and build something better that works for more people. And that's why I'm particularly excited and really looking forward to getting to hear from Thelma Golden and Oskar Eustis today, because well before 2020, these are arts leaders who have been doing that work of imagining and building different futures, trying to show us the way towards that new, more vibrant, more just future. It's work that they've been doing their whole careers, and I'm so excited to let us all hear more about their work and share more about that future that they imagine. I think if we were all in the same room right now, I would say something like, please join me in welcoming Thelma Golden and Oskar Eustis, and everyone would clap and it would be a very elegant transition. But since we are in this virtual Zoom room, I think I will say that and then there will be kind of an awkward pause and then I will hand it over to Thelma to start her introduction and share a little bit about her work. So please join me in welcoming Thelma Golden and Oskar Eustis.
Thank you so much, Laura. And I want to thank David and the Academy and say what an honor it is to be here with my dear colleague, Oskar, to be in this conversation, to think about artists and the creative workforce. And as Laura said, to think about the past, but also to be in a space of imagining new futures. By way of introduction, I'd like to say that I am the director and chief curator of the Studio Museum in Harlem, an institution that was founded in 1969 to preserve, present, collect, and interpret the work of artists of African descent, locally, nationally, and internationally. In thinking about what the Studio Museum is and has been, I'd just love to start here and ground a bit in art by an artist, Jacob Lawrence, one of the artists who was deeply involved in the founding of the Studio Museum, of course, iconic for his work as a painter. But I start with this image of Jacob Lawrence. It's from our collection, The Architect, 1959, made about 20 years almost after his major and significant migration series, because it pictures an architect and this imagining of building quite literally. But for the Studio Museum, this image has also been about this imagining of building worlds and building futures. And that is so much what the Studio Museum was about at its founding. I often say that our founders in our name, Studio Museum in Harlem, embedded mission, very literally. It is something that I think Oskar and I share, stewarding institutions who were named as a way to project into who and what they were. This work, also in our collection by the artist Glenn Ligon, Give Us a Poem, which takes the words of Muhammad Ali that were spoken when he was asked after a lecture to give us, the audience, a poem, Me We, has always stood as symbolic for us at the museum as an artwork positioned in our former lobby out on projecting out on 125th Street and in the building, but speaking to this idea of the individual and the community, and more specifically, creating the idea of what it is the idea of community can mean as we encounter not just art, but culture more broadly. When thinking about the artist workforce, a creative workforce, I think of our foundings, which are so rooted in Harlem. Right, the Harlem in our name, but the Harlem that existed at the time that Jacob Lawrence was born and lived in Harlem, and that is during the Harlem Renaissance, perhaps one of the greatest 20th century examples, right, of the dynamism of a creative workforce. The Harlem, pictured in these vintage photographs from both our collection and the collection of the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture, which picture a community in over the decades, but in its dynamism as the really psychic, spiritual, intellectual, cultural, political, and creative home of Black people. So as an institution at our founding, there was always sort of the potential that in creating an institution within values of the community, but also looking to reimagine, right, the values of a cultural community that were exclusive, narrow, did not necessarily in any way reflect the sort of broad diversity of artists and art making, the Studio Museum was founded by an incredible group of founders and greeted at its founding, this New York Times article in 68, with a sense of the possibility of what it meant to create an art museum in a community like Harlem, grounded in Black artists and Black culture, in and of and for, right, the people. This particularly is important to understand in our name why studio comes first. And that is because at the core of the Studio Museum's mission from its founding moment was always the idea of thinking of a museum as being responsible not only for the stewardship of objects and artworks, but for the support, the care of artists. And that has come in the form of the Studio Museum's residency program, which over our last 50 plus years has welcomed 3 Black artists every year to the museum, into our physical space, and supported them with space, time, and money. And in that support have created what can be the idea of what artists need and how they need it to not only survive, but to thrive. Now, this was key to our founders, many of them artists themselves, as I said, Jacob Lawrence, Ramir Bearden, Faith Ringel, Elizabeth Catlett, you know, a pantheon of just iconic artists, and very specifically the painter William T. Williams, who at the time of our founding was a young, newly minted MFA in painting from Yale, who drafted the first proposal for the residency. And I think that's important in this conversation because quite often the most creative solutions to thinking about how artists can be supported come from artists themselves. So to me, this is the first example of the Studio Museum's responsiveness to rethinking the kind of hierarchical relationship between artist, object, audience, and institution, and centering artists through the residency and our larger work at the core. The residency is sort of known as being rooted in this idea of creating the space for artists to do what it is their creative vision calls them to do, but understanding, right, all the structures that are necessary to make that happen, space to work in, support to allow the time to work, time, right, without commitments and conditions to allow for the most intensive creative process, and also community, a community of colleagues. So our studio program in many ways creates community among the artists that are in it, but the larger community of the museum itself. These are some views of our studio, former studios. And I say former because what I should say is that the studio museum is now closed, not simply because of the reason many museums have been closed over this year, but because in 2018, we closed our building to embark on a major expansion project to build a new building. So these former studios were in our building before we closed, showing a range of artists, but also in these installation shots of different studios through the eras. On the bottom left was Kehinde Wiley's studio when he was in our residency program, the very beginning of the practice that we have come to know in its importance in the world, but that was the very beginnings on his wall and so many other examples of that. In thinking about what it means to think about this as a museological function, or more significantly, what role institutions, arts institutions, can play, not only in the presentation of art, but in its creation and in the support and advocacy of our creators. Again, a range starting with Kehinde Wiley, Micheline Thomas, David Hammons, Allison Saar, Julie Moretti, Cliff Owens, Kerry James Marshall, just a small group of some of the many artists who have spent a year over these last 50 years with us at the Studio Museum, and whose visions and voices have become significant in the way in which the museum continues to transform in its relationship to thinking about itself as an institution that is creating futures for art, for itself, and for our community. This work, of course, is embedded in the life of the museum itself. And I think when we talk about creative workforce, we also have to talk about the role that our arts institutions play in our larger communities, the ways in which they interact and intersect with the many other kinds of institutions and organizations created to imagine our communities in the fullest ways. And at the Studio Museum's founding, it was a moment in Harlem's history where the idea of Harlem being able to live into not just its past, glorious past, understanding that history, revering that history, but it also was a way for the institution to always be positioned towards imagining and future making. In our work, this a selection of examples of the kind of work that has animated our space, our work, and our minds over the last decade. And so to talk about future and to talk about sort of a creative workforce and to think about artists, for me, grounds again in the place we are at the Studio Museum. This is a rendering of our new building as it will be in a few years on 125th Street, designed by Sir David Adjaye of Adjaye Associates with Cooper Robertson. This space is an embodiment of the values of transformative art making, of significant ways of thinking about site specificity, site suggestiveness in institution making. It is a manifestation of a sense of what has always been in the institution's life about creating space, space for Black artists, space for ideas, but also, I would say, the creation of space that moves beyond the physical, intellectual space, emotional space, even spiritual space, when we think about the place that culture plays in our understanding of ourselves and each other, and the importance of culture, right? And artists as our visionaries, as we imagine a world as we hope it to be. So I think this last year has put us all in the sort of deep reimagining, right, of what it is we need to create to imagine more justice and more equity. And the legacy of the Studio Museum, particularly because that legacy has been so built and formed by artists working in their fullest ways in the deep seat of their brilliance and genius, that our future also is being led by those very artist voices now and those to come. Thank you.
I'd rather keep listening to Thelma. I'd rather cede her my minutes, but I have a job to do here. Thelma is one of the most inspiring leaders we have in New York or anywhere in the country. And so I just, that was beautiful, Thelma. Thank you. And thank you, Laura. Thank you, David. Thank you, Academy, for this opportunity. I'm Oskar Eustis. I'm artistic director of the Public Theater here in New York. And we are theater, actually, as Thelma referred to, our actual motto is we are theater of, by, and for the people. And I want to talk just a little bit about the past of the public before I focus on what I think the challenge of our future is. The public was founded as an absolute democratic impulse to try to make Shakespeare available to everybody. We began as the New York Shakespeare Festival. Joe Papp came out of the Navy and started performing Shakespeare on the back of flatbed trucks around the boroughs and parks of Manhattan. Eventually, he won a famous battle with Robert Moses, and the Delacorte Theater was built in Central Park, where we still, to this day, do free Shakespeare in the Park every summer, except the summer of 2020, the first time that theater was ever dark. And that free Shakespeare is a huge and important part of our mission. But the success of Shakespeare in the Park also actually comes with a sort of poison pill. The theater's free, it's available to everybody. You can line up and get a ticket, but a theater that was created to make the theater more accessible to people has become one of the hardest tickets to get in New York City. Because although we've removed the economic barrier, there are so many other barriers to people getting to the Delacorte. So we revived the mobile unit, and the mobile unit now goes around to all five boroughs, even into Jersey and Westchester, performs in parks, prisons, halfway houses, battered women's shelters, reaching out to people who the culture has given the least to try to tell these stories to them and help them feel like they have a stake in this culture. They own it too. But what Joe also realized is that that act of giving Shakespeare to the people had a certain colonial tinge to it. There's a certain idea of we have culture and we're giving it to you that needed to be combated. So in 1968, he opened up the public theater down on Astor Place. And the job of the public theater was to take the voice of the people and put it on the stage to make a new canon, a canon for our age that gave voice to all of the people who make up this fabulous kaleidoscopic democracy. And new plays and musicals have been performing there since 1968, from Chorus Line to For Colored Girls, which I'm happy to say our revival is coming to Broadway in this coming season, to Hamilton, a wide range of activity. But all of that activity is about new plays. So the combination of new plays and Shakespeare is all about trying to turn the culture over to the people, both in terms of what culture they get to receive and what culture they get to make. It's been a great journey. I think it's a great theater. But we all know that you can never rest when it comes to inclusion. You can never rest when it comes to democracy. I think Harry Blackman said there's a penumbra around the Bill of Rights that's ever expanding. And I feel that that's true of the best of American democracy. We can never include enough people. So what's the challenge that we have right now? Because I think we're at a historical moment where things may be possible that haven't been possible previously. We've had periods of great democratic enfranchisement and expansion in this history that led to great theatrical renaissances in the 1930s. As a result of the Depression, Laura has referenced the WPA and the Federal Theater Project came out of that and the seeds of the serious American theater. In the 1960s, the civil rights movement, the anti-war movement, the Great Society movement, all produced this explosion of nonprofit theaters across the United States in a beautiful decentralization of the American theater. And now we're at a moment where it's possible that we could have another resurgence of democracy inclusion. It's also possible we could have the opposite. So it's our job to fight to make sure that coming back from COVID, that we're helping to contribute to this being a moment where America becomes more equal, where the distribution of value across the culture is more equitable, where there is more justice, more inclusion, and more people get to claim that they are at the center of what America is, that they are the subjects of America's history, not the objects. So one of the barriers that we've been exploring, leaping over, is embodied in something we call our Public Works Project. And the aim of the Public Works Project is actually to change the relationship between artist and audience. And the thesis that underlies public works is that artistry is not something that is possessed by a few and not possessed by the many, that can be made by the few and witnessed by the many, or observed or absorbed by the many, but rather that being an artist is an inherent part of being a human being, that every human being has the desire to express things artistically, has the ability to express things artistically, and has a story to tell, has something to say. And that maybe if we don't think of this as a binary, yes or no, but it's on a grade, on a gradient. Some of us get to practice being artists all day long, we're lucky. Other people only get to do it occasionally, but it's not a difference in kind. It's a difference in opportunity. So the Public Works Project aims to deliberately blur the distinction between professional and amateur. And every year for the last decade at the Delacorte in Central Park, we have put on a Public Works pageant, a big civic pageant in which hundreds of ordinary New Yorkers are performing side by side with Tony Award winning actors and actresses. In the picture you see before you, which is a beautiful picture of the stage for the Odyssey, which Laird de Besnay and Todd Almond created a few years back, you can see two actors, right, Brandon Victor Dixon and Karen Olivo, both of them Tony Award winners. And they're surrounded by people who we work with year round, from the Brownsville Senior Center in Brownsville, Brooklyn, the Center for Family Life in Queens, the Fortune Society, the Children's Aid Society, the Military Resilience Project, Domestic Workers United, the Union of Domestic Workers. We work with these community-based organizations all year round, and at the end of the year, put on this pageant. And I knew from the beginning that this project, which was the brainchild of Laird de Besnay, was going to be great social justice work, was going to be wonderful social work for the people in it. What I didn't realize is that it was the best theater I was going to see all year. And that's turned out to be true every year for 10 years, a kind of brilliant living example of the thesis that everyone is an artist. And the electricity that shoots through the Delacorte when these performances happen is an electricity that I believe is in response to seeing that thesis embodied, that the art really belongs to all of us. The theater belongs to all of us. The city belongs to all of us. We in the theater, we literally do what we often speak of metaphorically. We put people center stage. We put the spotlight on people. The theater is a fantastic venue for lifting up and celebrating stories that are normally not celebrated or not part of the mainstream narrative. People who have been excluded from the mainstream narrative, we can celebrate them. And this is what I think the challenge facing us now, coming back from COVID. We have to come back better. We can't just come back. We have to come back, and now I'm speaking really as a theater artist, proving that the theater has something to offer for far more people than it did before COVID. We have to come back and say, we can remake the relationship of the theater in the society if we look at it differently. Public Works over the last 10 years has had a spectacular sticky effect. And as we come into this time where maybe we're starting to believe that the government can play an active role in leveling the playing field for its citizens, maybe the government is once again going to be empowered with the ability to support the values of America, not simply stay out of the way and let the market drive the values of America. Maybe this is a moment when we can prove that the theater and the arts in general have a binding role to play, have a role to play to put us together again as a nation. And we should aspire to no less. That's the potential of the art form. And for those of who run institutions, that's what we have to strive for. There's much more to say about the subject, but I will leave it at that for now. Thanks.
Thank you both so much. That was just amazing to get to hear about your work and see those beautiful pictures and see even the through lines between your work and hopefully a little bit of ours too. I'm gonna share a little bit of Springboard's work now. So Springboard for the Arts is an artist-run organization a staff of 17 mighty artists who are all practicing artists in all different disciplines. Our headquarters and our home bases for this work are in St. Paul, Minnesota and Fergus Falls, Minnesota. Both of those locations are on land that was and is home to the Ojibwe and Dakota people. In Springboard's sort of definition of art and artist, we consider art as meaning making in everyday life. And that demands a really broad definition of who artists are and who gets to call themselves an artist. And our work specifically prioritizes artists and communities who have at best not been resourced by the existing nonprofit art system, and in many cases been extracted from. So artists who are Black and Indigenous, artists who are immigrants, and artists who are people of color, artists with disabilities, GLBTQ artists, and artists in rural places. Springboard is also an organization that I think is characterized by things that sometimes other people might see as contradictions, but we see as assets. So we are both urban and rural. We are intensely place-based and neighborhood-focused and also national in our aspiration. And all of our work is around this vision that we have that we can build a world where artists are essential to just and vibrant local economies and to more human-centered systems. I sort of think about all of our work as both deeply practical. So a lot of our work is really rooted in connecting people directly with the resources and the things they need. But also our work, everything we do are these sort of signals to the universe of what else is possible and these small examples of what's possible if we do imagine that things could be different. This is an example of that that we're taking on right now. This is an in progress of our new headquarters and home base in the Frogtown and Rondo neighborhood in St. Paul, former used car dealership that was vacant for 15 years that we're turning into a community space and a hub for creativity and the neighborhoods and communities around us. Sometimes I frame our work with this idea that we call creative people power, which is really rooted in the idea that creativity and creative people are analogous to a natural resource, or they are a natural resource and a source of energy and power for their communities, and that they exist on every block, in every neighborhood, in every community, big or small, around the world, and that they are a tremendous source of power for addressing big challenges, building connections, and for recognizing community expertise that exists in those places already. But just like other natural resources, we need systems that help us plug into that power. You can live in a very sunny place and not have access to solar energy unless someone builds the solar panels. And so Springboard is a solar panel organization. The sun already exists. Art and creativity already exists. Our job is to build the system to tend to that natural resource and take care of it better, make it more sustainable, and to help people connect more easily into that power and energy. What does that actually look like? And what does it look like to build an ecosystem of support that really centers artists and creativity? I think, you know, if I were giving this talk a year and a half ago, I would have reached back over the last 16 years of examples of programs and projects. Perhaps one silver lining of the terrible, terrible last year and a half is that I can just tell you about the last year. And it kind of sums up what I've been calling a year of kind of horrible validation for the need for a system and a lot of real clear examples of the lack of that system in many, many places. So the last year has showed us just how fragile artists' lives are and livelihoods are, and revealed to many, many more people that we have an emergency of inequity for artists and for communities that are impacted by multiple crises. Artists were among the first to lose their jobs and contracts as the bottom fell out at the beginning of the pandemic. And more than a year later, the unemployment statistics for artists are still really heartbreaking. For some disciplines, the unemployment rate remains over 50%, and something close to 95% of all artists in this country report that they've had income loss over the last year. So this is what we do. We went to work. We scaled an existing emergency relief fund that we already had, a fund that typically supported 20 artists a year with $10,000 to raise $1.5 million and support over 2,500 artists and culture bearers in our region. We also built a network. We wrote a guide for how to start an emergency relief fund and started convening people. And in the end, helped about 100 locally based emergency relief funds for artists get up and running to really help provide that critical stopgap help for people just to pay rent and buy groceries. We focused on these direct resources, things like emergency relief, health and wellness support, but also navigating unemployment and PPP loans, things that were not built for people who are patching together a living from a dozen different contracts, sometimes more. We advocated and connected artists with city and county and state small business relief programs. We convened and coached, helped people move their businesses online. We published these two new free handbooks. One is a revision of a longtime business skills program that Springboard's run for several decades, and a brand new handbook for artists working in community. Those are both resources available on our website. Part of why we focused on that handbook for artists working in community is that we knew that as these crises compounded, that artists want and need to get to work, and that work is helping their communities and using their creative skills and processes to help people express grief and rage and find solace and connection. Based on our previous community development work in the last year, we stood up a new program called Artists Respond. Its first effort was to support Black artists directly in our neighborhood to paint murals and work with community in the immediate days after the murder of George Floyd at the hands of Minneapolis police. We moved on from that and added a coalition of artists who worked statewide to design projects that combat social isolation, especially among our most vulnerable populations, and most recently supported a new group of rural artists of color who are all doing projects that challenge our ideas of what and who rural is and who gets to tell the story of rural. We relaunched our popular community-supported art program, which is a CSA that delivers art instead of vegetables. This year, we did it through the U.S. Postal Service so people could directly connect with art experiences at home. All of these projects are really small in nature. Springboard believes in the idea of lots of little, and they're demonstrations, resources, connection points. I'm super proud of all of this work, all of the ways that we've been able to support artists to do what they need to do in the last year to get to work and frankly, just to get money in their pockets. But none of these are actually system changes, and system change is what we need right now. So right now, as an organization, we're transitioning to imagining what's next, like a lot of people are right now, and really thinking about what are the systemic changes that are possible. The thing I always come back to in this question about what artists need is that the things that artists need is an economy that works better for everyone. Artists need the same things as everyone else. They need healthcare, they need childcare, they need help with student loans, they need renter protections. And those are things that can't be accomplished by the arts community alone. They have to be in solidarity and collaboration with other movements and other advocacy for policy change. So along those lines, last month, we announced a new pilot of a guaranteed income program for individual artists in our neighborhood in St. Paul. This pilot is intentionally designed to align with and partner with a network of pilots that are rolling out all across the country that are not focused on individual artists, primarily through the amazing network called Mayors for Guaranteed Income, started by Mayor Michael Tubbs from Stockton, California. And our goal with this project is, of course, again, to practically get money into the hands of artists when they really, really need it. But I think almost more importantly, our goal for this project is to really ensure that artists more broadly are included in this movement around economic justice and in these kinds of ideas like guaranteed income, so that they can bring their skills and their practice and their work to the task ahead of changing the narrative and building this future vision for a better economy that they, along with a lot of other people, could benefit from. None of this work that I've talked about really is new, right? Like, and it doesn't exist because Springboard exists or because any of these institutions exist. Artists and culture bearers have been working to make their communities and neighborhoods and systems better, more connected and more just for generations, long before the idea of nonprofits existed. And just like other small business owners and independent workers, artists often operate without a safety net and within systems that extract and devalue their work and their labor. So our eyes are firmly planted on dismantling those systems and rebuilding something better. What we want to do is seed these locally rooted ecosystems that support and sustain artists and culture bearers and their communities so that they can do the work of imagining and building a future that values individual and community needs, and not just the individual and community needs for things like safety and security and health, but also from the much more fundamental needs that we all have for meaning and connection and love. Putting my moderator hat back on now. Thank you both, Oskar and Thelma, so much for sharing your work and the beautiful images. I know there's sort of, especially in this Zoom world, there's a kind of extra pressure for folks in the arts field to have good, you better have good visuals, right? And you both do, which I think is only a reflection of your amazing work. Because today's conversation is focused on the idea of individual artists and creative workers, I'm wondering just to start off with if either or both of you could reflect a little bit on if anything has changed for you in the last year and a half or so about how you think about what artists need or who artists are. Have the multiple crises of the last year changed anything about how you think about individual artists?
It's changing everything. And Laura, to tell you the truth, I don't feel like we've settled in to understand what's happened in the last year completely. What I know, there's been two huge movements that have affected us. And one is recognizing that we have to strengthen our relationships to our community. We've always cared about that. But it's so interesting that both of you also talk very much about art springing from a community and artists living in and being part of a community. And that dialogue has got to deepen for the theater, for my theater, but I think for the theater as a field. We have to be embedded in ways that, yeah, I'll use this language, they're less commodity oriented, that are less about us producing something that other people buy, but more about a set of relationships and proving our value in that way rather than in the commodity making and transactional way. I'm sure of that. The other thing is that the American theater, of course, has been going through a lot of the same racial reckoning that the society as a whole has gone through. And we've been forced to take a good hard look at ourselves. And what we have found is not altogether pleasing. For the public specifically, that, I mean, I'm just picking one aspect of this, but it's an aspect that, you know, is very important to me. Recognizing that there is a contradiction between the values that the public professes on stage, what we say we care about in our work and what we do care about in our work, and the way we ourselves are actually organized. Because for a theater that talks an awful lot about the community and about collectivity and equality and collegiality, we have always had a dominant, charismatic, megafauna artistic director. And we are structured very hierarchically that way. And that's not going to do anymore. That's actually not right. It probably never was right, but it certainly is not right now. And so we are beginning some pretty exciting experiments with how do we maintain the excellence and the quality of everything we do while diversifying the decision-making and the diversity of voices who get a say in what we do. And for an old guy like me, that's been hard. It's a big challenge. And I feel like at moments, I feel like I should throw up my hands and just say, I got to pass it off to the next guy and let them try to make it work. But I don't think that's the right answer. I think the right answer is that I have to learn new tricks and we have to discover new ways of working together. So that's my answer.
Yes. And I think, you know, in your answer, Oskar, is some of my response to this, Laura, about what I might, you know, have come to in this last year. And it was this constant need to root myself in history, the history of my own organization that came out of the cauldron of the late 60s with almost exactly, right, the same sets of circumstance that the institution in its formation was responding to and trying to create. So what it really for me was about understanding our need to continue to create the space for this transformation to happen for individual artists. So that's about support, right? Because this effort on the studio museum's part was a major equity play. It was can we support artists in a way that those artists can then shift and change, right? The landscape, in our case, of visual arts. Can we create an institution that in its formation can transform the notion of what institution could be? You know, that's where I go back to the naming. I love that the founder is sort of rooted in that because it was about that. So in this moment, I say the very same things, right? What as we are recreating, what has this last year shown us? It is opened up a recognition of the reality of the inequities, right, that have existed in our culture world, in our communities, and the necessity to be so focused, right, on the reimagination towards a more democratic, justice-filled, justice-led space for us all to exist in. That's perhaps how I might reflect on how this last year has kept me in the future and the past at the same moment.
Yeah, you know, listening to you both talk, I'm really struck by so much of the time it feels like to me when we talk about individual artists inside the arts community, that conversation gets kind of characterized as oppositional between artists and institutions. And both of you are so dedicated to individual artists and speak with so much affection and understanding for the role that they play in the work and in this kind of broader definition of who artists are. I wonder, and you both have these tremendous responsibilities to lead what are quite large just businesses, right? And so I wonder, as you think about your role in leadership of those institutions, do those things ever feel like they're intention for you, your commitment to individual artists and your kind of responsibility to run the organization or to be committed to the institution?
I think, you know, my own work as an administrator, as an arts leader, is deeply informed by the visions of artists of what they want and need from institution. So that I see, you know, my role as being one as an active co-conspirator. And that again is legacy I carry from an institution that had that at its formation. So I think perhaps sometimes the false dichotomy, right, between the artist and the institution, I think sort of was reconciled in our early founding in the partnership between artists, administrators, activists, right, to create something wholly new. I think the challenge for that, Laura, now is the ways in which we have these arts worlds that are commercial worlds that sort of stand in as example for the entire world. So in the visual arts world, there is a whole world of visual artists who do not exist by exclusion, by choice, and everything in between in the market. So it is, I think, the responsibility, and this is the learning for me, the inspiration from artists, in really being able to represent the sort of full totality of our world and to carry that forward always, right? To represent that in the fullest way.
Yeah, you know, I was struck as we've been working on this, and learning from folks in the kind of world around guaranteed income and that movement, I've been struck several times by the idea that, like, oh, we used to do this for artists. Like, it was called a rep company, right? Like, that was guaranteed income for artists. Right. And now we have to kind of step outside of a lot of the existing infrastructure that's been built specifically around arts and culture and look for models from other places. But some of those, I think, maybe are an opportunity to connect back to some of the systems that we've had and lost. Not that those systems were worked for everyone or were just in a lot of ways, but as examples that it maybe isn't as far-fetched as it sounds. I guess on that note, before we go to the Q&A, I'd love to hear you both just talk a little bit about, as you look forward to the future, what that kind of dream for a new system for artists looks like. I think, you know, there are a lot of ideas that have floated around for a long time, and particularly in the last year, around how to put artists to work or how what kind of system is missing. Or I know a lot of times in the US people point to, you know, federally subsidized systems that exist in other countries and the ways that we resource art and culture in other places. So I'm wondering if you have ideas either sort of big picture visions or practical ideas for what those future systems should be?
Well, I think the practical idea is the one that has been discussed for over, you know, a century, and has had moments, right, of evidence, and that is the direct support to artists as workers. I mean, I want to, in many ways, sort of imagine, right, that we are at a point where we can understand why this is not only a necessity, but an amazing opportunity to sort of transform the way in which we can think about our cultures. And I think this has an impact in places, of course, like New York, but a really significant impact all around the country, right? If our artists can live, work, and be supported deeply and root in community, whatever definition of that, they connect to, that would be transformative. But I also feel our future needs to continue to create institutional models that create support for artists to work, not to work on behalf of us all, but to work on behalf of themselves and their creative genius. So perhaps that's contradictory, but I want a future that allows more space, right? That creates more possibility, but does so in ways that are deeply generative, that don't only embrace what might be a kind of outcomes-oriented version of artist support, but a real sort of creation of care, right? For the creative geniuses among us, you know, and to Oscar's point, you know, and I mean that in the widest way, because that's the other part of when we think about the future, right? Who gets defined as an artist? You know, and again, I feel thrilled to be part of an institution that really had a lot to do with opening up that definition. But I think that, you know, as both of our organizations have been a part of, that we are pushing against still hierarchies that have relatively narrow definitions that are just waiting to be. We know this, our publics, our audiences understand, right, the complexity of possibility. And so to have institutional spaces, right, begin to lean into that will also be, I think, a future that we might hope for.
That's fantastic. I look in two directions. What can my institution do? And what can we try and get the world to do? One of the things that the institution can do is we can put more artists on payroll. Sudenly Parks has been getting a salary from the public and retirement benefits and health benefits for a decade. The model is a chair in the university. What's her responsibilities? Nothing except to write the play she wants to write. We don't even own them, but she writes them. And every theater in the country should have such chairs. We need to take responsibility, a greater sense of responsibility, for supporting the artists who make our field. In terms of government, the absolute things the government can do to make the ecology better for the arts. There could be a housing program. The artist in residence program that New York City had when I arrived here in 1974 changed my life, made my life possible. New York has become unlivable for artists in terms of expense. Maybe this is a moment with a lot of empty office space, we can turn that around. Also, who gets to be a professional artist? I'm really hoping that we can get into the infrastructure bill that the president's currently offering, workforce development funds, that would allow for paid apprenticeships at the public theater, where we could pair with City College, pair with Brooklyn College, and be able to bring in salaried folks who learn the disciplines, the lighting, the costuming, all of the technical disciplines of the theater, and that there's a career there. I myself was a product of the Comprehensive Education and Training Act. My first job in 1972 was the government paid my salary to attract me into the nonprofit sector. And guess what? It worked. Here I am 50 years later. That's something that governments can do. And I think maybe we're at a moment when we can start to push for, you know, all of these different changes in the ecology to make life easier for being an artist.
Yeah, I love both of those ideas. I think those are those are both the future I want. David, I think we will bring you back with some audience Q&A.
Good. Thanks, Laura, and thank you for a great discussion there. There are quite a few questions. We probably won't be able to get to all of them, but several people are asking about the role of the federal government. You've talked about local initiatives, but how can we bring in the federal government? Rachel Moore asks about the passage of Shared Avenue Operates grant by Congress. Is there a change of opinion about the value of the arts at the federal level? Can we leverage it? And how can the arts get a seat at the federal table? So there's several questions around that.
Just very quickly say that we're certainly trying. Last summer, Nataki Garrett, Maria Gianis, and I put together a coalition, which is now 70 theaters strong, that lobbied very intensively for the what used to be the Save Our Stages bill, and it was called the Shuttered Venues Operating Grant. And, you know, along with other organizations, we, I don't want to take sole credit, but we had an impact. We were successful. We are now staying together as a coalition and specifically trying to influence the infrastructure bill. And we have to organize and do what is necessary to actually be heard politically. And we're not used to doing that. I'm a very political guy, but this is the first time in my entire career I've been part of this kind of federal lobbying effort. And it feels like it might be a good moment for it.
I agree. And I think that what we understood is that the starkness of need in the last year made it very clear that our only ability to move forward was to engage at a federal level, right? I think we all had engaged at a local level, maybe even regional, but to think about it. And I do think that where we will be even a year from now will potentially create a roadmap for what a sustained federal effort could look like in all ways.
Good, thanks. Here's a question about, the challenges around, you've talked about the guaranteed income pilot, Laura, and about the needs of artists in some ways being related to those of the larger population. There's a question about tension around gentrification and artists moving into BIPOC communities, where sometimes there are conflicts between local communities and artists who see their communities changing, maybe in ways that concern them when artists come into their community.
Absolutely. I think there's two important things about this question that are sort of, I think, two ideas that we have to hold at the same time. One is that there is no community where artists don't already exist. So if you're, you know, talking about a community that is worried about displacement and gentrification, there are artists there who are from and of that community already. So I think sometimes we are sort of on shaky ground when we characterize artists only as this external force that comes in or to be imported or as a force for gentrification. There are culture bearers, there are culture workers and tradition bearers in those communities already. And from my perspective, that is a really important piece of how we push back against displacement and gentrification by supporting the artists who are from and of that community already. You know, displacement happens both economically and culturally. And so partly our pilot, our guaranteed income pilot, specifically focuses on the artists who are from and of our neighborhood. We focused on a specific geography, and that's true outside of the arts in a lot of the work that's happening around guaranteed income. And I think an important distinction between guaranteed income and what people call universal basic income is that a lot of people think about guaranteed income as something that can be targeted and focused on people who need that support and need to be resourced because they are from and of communities that have been extracted from and harmed by existing systems. The other thing, the thing about artists and their association with gentrification, I think is also an important idea to hold, though. I think artists have often been used as a kind of shield or a kind of cloak for developers who are ultimately the people who cause gentrification. But, you know, they've wittingly and unwittingly been used as a kind of vanguard to make way sometimes, or to make things like affordable housing more palatable to neighborhoods and to push other people out. And I think that if we are going to do this work in solidarity with these other movements, then we need to come to it with the clarity around what our values are and what the ethics are. And it's part of why I believe so strongly that this work to build these new systems has to be in collaboration with other communities, that we can't consider artists a kind of special class of people who deserve things that other people don't have access to. It has to be a part of how we're building more economically just and more fair systems for the benefit of everyone.
Thanks.
Beautifully said.
Okay. Here's a question directed at Oskar, but really any of you. Oskar, I really appreciated how you linked art and democracy. Can you elaborate more on the relationship between a healthy democracy and democratic institutions and how artists benefit?
Let me just do real quick. That theater is about the idea that the truth emerges from the conflict between different points of view. That's what created theater, which is why theater was created and democracy was created in Athens in the 6th century BC, because it requires you to believe that that conversation is where truth lies, not in any one individual, but in conflict and drama and connection. It also requires that if you're going to enjoy the drama, that you're capable of imagining what somebody else feels. You're capable of seeing the world through somebody else's point of view. And those two emblematic acts are, to my mind, the emblematic pillars of a democratic society. We need citizens who can imagine things from other people's point of view, and we need citizens who believe that the truth is to be discovered in dialogue with people who disagree with you. And I believe that really deeply, and that it manifests both on a surface level, but also manifests on a quite deep spiritual level.
Good. Thank you. Here are a couple of questions about colleges and universities. Harry Elam asks about possible arts partnerships with colleges and universities. And another attendee asks about the role of universities in supporting the artistic workforce, and are they falling short at the present time?
So. Sure. Well, first, hi, Harry. And he's asking that question as someone who, you know, really created, important partnerships between artists and universities, students, faculty, community. And I think that that's exactly it. And I think if we imagine that the space of college and universities, right, are ones that are open to this ongoing inquiry, right, around the arts and humanities, that artists, as teachers, but also again, as members of this sort of wider community, these partnerships, like for me at a museum, are incredibly impactful, right? They allow us to exist in ways that broaden the scope of the work, but also allow for real sense of possibility in audience and in creating and generating new ideas. It's really the space in which, again, I think in creative collaboration, but this is, you know, to me, one of the most critical ones, the academy, the arts institution, and the community of artists, that really drives us in forward in deeply creative ways.
I think that's absolutely right. And I would add sort of, specifically to the question of sort of where are universities lagging or where is our arts education maybe have some room as a field. There are certainly great exceptions to both of these, but I think the first thing I would name is education around the making a living and a life part. that piece often, you know, we still see artists all the time who haven't had access to, like, how would I run this? I mean, we've talked for the last hour plus and about all of the ways that artists essentially have to run their own business to make a living as an artist now, and often don't get any of that kind of skill-based kind of real brass tacks piece. And the other piece, I think, connected to what Thelma was saying, is that I think there's so much more room for universities and education institutions to be helping artists understand the ethics and the practices around working in community early in their careers. I think it's something that particularly young artists really, really want. And I think still isn't really baked into a lot of our educational structure, how you approach partnership, how you understand the needs of a community, how you understand whether it's yours to enter or yours to be a part of, how you set clear expectations and have really clear conversations with those kind of community partners, that I think people really, I do think people really want that. And I think there's a lot of space for universities to do more there.
Thanks. While we're on the subject of education, the Commission on the Arts, as you know, is also focused on arts education. And I'm curious about educational initiatives at your organization. So do you have particular relationships with local schools reaching out to arts for everyone?
Let me actually just say something about that, because it's important to me. If I go back to my seated job in 1972 in Laura's home state in Minneapolis, that was a great thing for me, right? But I didn't realize till a decade later that I had been used the way real estate developers use artists. That me being employed at, you know, $75 a week to show up and do a couple of classes in schools was part of a move to get rid of dedicated arts teachers from our public school curriculum, that we were supposed to somehow fill that gap. And I've sworn ever since I realized that I would never have a theater that participates in that. What kids need in the schools is dedicated arts teachers who are teachers and who are there all the time teaching the arts. We can't allow ourselves to be used to bust those jobs. That said, there's a lot of things that as a professional arts institution that I've found that we can do in relationship to schools that's only what we can do, which is produce professional work. And that, you know, we've been engaged in a project up at Hunts Point, the Hunts Point Children Alliance, that's been fantastic. You know, there's things we can do, but we need to go into it as professional artists doing what we know how to do, not replacing professional teachers who are doing, should be doing what they know how to do.
Very well put. Oh. Thelma, I'm curious about this studio museum and relationships with schools.
Yes. Yes, the Studio Museum from our founding has been committed to being a presence in the educational life of schools in Harlem and throughout the city. But specifically in Harlem, our relationship, again, has been to be a partner, right? To reimagine what the relationship between the museum and a school could be, which moves beyond simply the idea, as Oskar said, putting an artist in a classroom or allowing for tours, but really being a partner in education. But our work in the last 30 years, I think, has transformed to think about the work of arts education as not just being what happens in the classroom, but what happens in a young person's whole life. So much of our educational programming is also about creating this space in after-school time, in weekend, in community, with family, and really creating an educational space that sort of opens itself to the idea that this isn't just a classroom-based endeavor, right? And allow the museum to become, again, as an anchor in the community, a space in which, defined by art, but is also deeply invested in creating that kind of, you know, educational opportunity at all times. And in our new building, this again is made manifest in the architecture, which really creates physical spaces that don't privilege sort of the classroom from what essentially is a space in which creating and creativity can happen no matter how a young person comes to us. Class visit, parent, school visit, community group visit.
Good, thank you. A last question for all three of you. The audience who's listening to you right now includes, of course, some arts leaders, of course, but also policymakers and general public and so forth. So how can, what is your call to action for this audience? How can all of us in the audience help to participate in efforts to develop the creative workforce? I'm interested in quick response from each of the three of you. Maybe, Laura, do you wanna start?
Sure. I mean, I think my call to action is for each of us individually to figure out in our own lives and our own communities how we can support artists directly. So the ways that we might change our spending habits locally to be able to invest in and support artists that matter in our communities and that we can connect directly with, the ways that we can lift up and share the work of individual artists directly and direct other people there, and the ways that we can be engaged politically around both things that specifically impact artists, but around these broader things we've been talking about and bring to those conversations an understanding that that impacts artists and the cultural life of our communities.
Thanks. Oskar, words for the audience?
Yeah, I would just say that we've talked about a lot of different things that we can do to fight for support for artists. What I would say is just make sure that every time you're doing that, you're questioning who gets to be an artist. And are we actually using whatever initiative we have to open up the doors so that the stories that get told on our stages or in our other arts are as diverse as the country itself. Because if we don't think about that, we won't create the underpinning that will allow the whole field to thrive.
Thelma?
Yes, and my call to action would be one that just centers equity, to understand that in our reimagining that we don't want to recreate some of the systems that already exist. You know, as a leader, you know, of a Black institution, one that is rooted in community, that lives internationally with an international sense of our relationship to a global community, I would like the call to action to be one that really also speaks to support of artists, but support of these ways of thinking about organization and institution that center equity.
Thank you. So thank you, Laura, Thelma, Oskar, for all your work and for joining us today. Your contributions have been so thoughtful and are very much appreciated. And I'd like to thank everyone for taking part in today's event and be on the lookout for future publications and events related to the Academy's Commission on the Arts. So goodbye. Have a great afternoon. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. You.